We go now to the nation of Colombia, where one of the most brutal and long-lasting civil wars in South America appeared to be coming to a peaceful end earlier this month. But the landmark peace agreement between the government and rebels was narrowly rejected in a nationwide referendum. Now, both sides are struggling to pick up the pieces. Special correspondent Nadja Drost and her producer Bruno Federico have this report.
It happened barely more than a month ago, but it seems like another age. A moving and hopeful ceremony in the port city of Cartagena to mark what many Colombians never thought possible. The armed insurgency FARC and the government signing off on a peace agreement to end 52 years of war. In front of hundreds at the shore, a women's choir sings a goodbye to war and a welcome to peace. They brought their traditional songs of mourning to the ceremony from here, Bojaya, a town reached only by river in the isolated northwest of Colombia, in a church where they commemorate those who lost their lives in what has become a symbol of the war's brutality. On May 2, 2002, hundreds of residents were taking shelter in this church from fighting between paramilitaries and FARC guerrillas when the guerrillas launched a homemade mortar round. It landed inside the church, killing 79 people, over half of them children. Later, thousands fled, tearing apart the community. Since then, the church has been rebuilt and maintained in memory of the victims and survivors, like Macaria Ayin.
I was here with my three children. The cylinder bomb fell over there. This whole area was full of people. Everyone who was around here died. Everyone. No one was left alive.
The village was eventually abandoned, its residents displaced throughout the region, until it was relocated a mile upstream. Since the massacre, Bojaya has continued to suffer the worst of the conflict, caught in the crossfire of FARC guerrillas fighting the army and paramilitaries, the river and its banks converted into a large cemetery. Máxima Espria is one of the women who sang in Cartagena.
When I was singing, and that's why we sang with such emotion and effort, the only thing I was thinking was, we want peace.
Perhaps because of being so hard hit by the conflict, Bojaya residents voted overwhelmingly, 95%, in support of the peace accords. Now, with the peace deal rejected nationally and mired in uncertainty, many here fear they may have lost their only and long-awaited chance to live in peace.
We feel abandoned, betrayed. We thought they would support us, those who have lived the war. The half country who voted for no turned their back on us.
The peace process, throughout its 4 years of negotiations, has generated fierce political debates, and the criticism by vocal opponents prompted President Juan Manuel Santos to call the referendum, with the hope that a show of public support could strengthen the deal.
Many people warned me against it, but I said, well, this is something that I believe would be positive for the whole process. The decision backfired because we lost by a very small margin.
With only 37% of voters bothering to go to the polls, and the no side winning by a mere 53,000 votes out of 13.5 million, there is perhaps no one more consumed with why the deal was rejected than the man who just won the Nobel Peace Prize for its signing.
Why do you think that Colombians voted against the peace accords?
Of course, there's been a lot of misinformation, a lot of lack of information, and maybe I'm a bit responsible for not being more effective in this process of telling people what the agreement was all about.
The peace accords were defeated by a no campaign led by Santos's arch rival and former president Álvaro Uribe and his Central Democratic Party. But the campaign has been questioned over the claims it made to voters, that the country would become a socialist state like Venezuela, or that FARC leaders would receive impunity for their crimes. Rodrigo Aprimni, a constitutional law expert close to the peace talks, says the no campaign even made claims that had nothing to do with the peace accord.
They say to them, this peace accord is going to destroy your family because this peace accord is in favor of homosexuality, which quite clearly is not true.
Ivan Zuluaga, the Central Democratic Party's director and a former presidential candidate who lost to Santos in the last election, says the no vote's victory sends a clear mandate to overhaul the agreements.
They have to recognize that Colombians vote for it, so they have to accept not only the government, but even the FARC, deep changes, fundamental changes.
FARC leaders have said they are open to making some changes, but warn it will be difficult to change the agreement's core. We traveled via river from Bohaya to visit a FARC unit, mid-level commanders known as Pablo Atrato and Nathalie Mistral, a French citizen, led us to a camp where their troops, like thousands of others spread out amongst jungle enclaves, are waiting amid the uncertainty. Both Mistral and Atrato were at negotiations in Havana.
After years of negotiations, to resolve all this in 2 or 3 months, I don't think it's possible.
The peace accords will grant immunity to much of the FARC's rank and file, but those accused of crimes against humanity will receive alternative sentences in exchange for confessing the truth, not jail, but restrictions on their liberty. But many in the opposition say that is unacceptable.
They have to go to jail 5 years. If they are in jail, they are not able to be eligible politically. Yeah, and instead of that, the treatment says, and the agreement with the FARC says that they are not going to jail and they can be eligible for any major president, Congress, for example.
But that's the deal. If you want an armed political actor like the FARC to become a peaceful political actor, then you cannot block them to make politics. That's the crucial issue in a peace accord.
I'm not willing to spend time in jail, and I'm not willing to let my superiors go to jail either. To serve jail time would nullify us politically. It's unacceptable within a peace negotiation.
While Santos has said his government is trying to satisfy the no side, he's made clear there will be disagreement on issues in reaching a new agreement. But Santos's government and the FARC face an enormous challenge. Making sufficient changes to the peace agreement to gain broader support of the public without making the tectonic shifting changes that could break it down.
The risks are that this gets drawn out and we end up again in a spiral of war. I think that's how it could end up if we're not capable in the next 2 or 3 months to find a way out of this.
I am absolutely determined not to allow the country to go back to war with the FARC. The FARC doesn't want it, we don't want it. And we're trying to find the best and the most rapid path to get out of this situation, and that's to have a new agreement as soon as possible.
Santos told us he hopes to get a new peace deal by the end of the year, but delay could jeopardize the current ceasefire. Bohaya residents like Maxima Espria are finally feeling peace in their town and have seen changes among the FARC.
After having signed the ceasefire, they got into a different mode and the tension went down.
In fact, the FARC even apologized to the community last year.
We ask you to forgive us.
After so many years of singing lamentations for their dead, these women hope to have a reason to compose a song in celebration of life and the peace they so badly want. We Colombians, they sing, ask that war not repeat. But whether Bohaya's plea for peace is answered is far from certain. From Bohaya, Colombia, reporting with Bruno Federico, I'm Nadja Drost for the PBS NewsHour.
And you can see more of Nadia's interview with the Colombian president on our website, pbs.org/newshour.